Greetings in the blessed name of Yahshua HaMashiach. The power of his great blessings, the riches of Almighty Yahweh that reveals unto us above all things the greatness of his value. He is beyond the value of comprehension. And how precious is the dam, the blood of Yahshua, that all the earth with all of his offerings could not be enough and sufficient for one drop of his precious dam. I believe that. I've lived too long in the essence, the vitality of life escapes every day. There's no other purpose for me to live. I don't want to seek some other way. I'm not looking for any other avenue. I'm not looking for any kind of thrill of excitement. I'm not looking to tour Rome or the continent of Africa. I want to express like the old ones would say, I want to be ready when you come. When the time beckons, when life in this form shall be no more, I want to be ready. And so I am preparing one thing, and that's to see him. Nothing else in life has any content at all, nothing. I know we may value things, our husbands, our wives, our children. That's wonderful. But nothing takes precedent over him. Nothing. Nothing. And so I'm glad today. Not only am I glad, I'm happy. And that's a fact. I have no complaints at all, nothing of any ill that works in my mind and takes commanding control and power over me. I don't have that today, and that's a fact. I'm not liking one thing at all because everything that I need, I find it in the comfort of Yahshua HaMashiach. That's all I need. And for that I am eternally blessed. My heart sings with the chorus of Toda Yada Yehuda, my precious Abba, for he is great and he is mighty. We do again greet you all that have joined us via the live stream. Our enemies and the few friends we have, if I have any. But we greet you all. Yahshua's mighty name. And you are enemies. You're here for one reason. Because you're hungry. And so the Torah commands that if your enemy is hungry, feed him. And so if you can sit through the course of this 7-part meal, each anointing of the Ruach, Ruach of wisdom, the fear of Yah, understanding, Da'at, then you will be fed a perfect meal today. Now, if you turn it off, then that's your loss. But if you listen, you will be fed. So quiet the house down. Tell your children to sit down. Discipline them. It's amazing that families can sit and watch 3 hours movies and the children are glued. They go to the theater, which is the synagogue of hell. Let no one trick you. And they sit for hours without making a move and everyone is still and quiet. Your attention is not drawn to someone over here, someone over there. You are enraptured in the movie. Get awful quiet on that. I will say it again, the theater houses are the synagogues of hell. There's nothing that is presented from that delusion, but one of the most damnable, twisted lies. These individuals make lying a way of life. You can say it's all right, it's not all right. You can say that it is permissible, but it's not permissible. Hallelujah. So they can sit through that. And you can teach them to sit to the service of Yah. Parents don't have to tell their children to be quiet in theaters. I don't know how it is today, but the last time I went to a theater, the movie I watched was Brubaker. I believe that was in 1979, somewhere in that range, Brubaker. And I saw this young man that we were in school together. He was one of those apostolics. He wore a suit and tie every day. And I saw him coming out of the cinema, my Isha and I going, and something was drastically wrong. And he looks at me with this look, and the same look I'm looking at him. He said to me, "You're wrong for coming here. That was the last time." You may not like it, but you don't understand the dynamics of that and the power of what it does and the strength that it takes in the life, not only of you, but those that you cause to embrace that. It is damnable. It is twisted. It is delusional that you can sit through a plethora of lies. You get fearful. You will cry over some damnable, twisted slut of a whore. Yeah, you will. And yet you don't shed tears for the house. Yes. Something is wrong with you, my friend. Yes. And of course, I brought just what the doctor needs you to have. Hallelujah. I bring the doctor, the Rapha, yes, the healer's medicine. Hallelujah. And it will heal you because I will send forth his word today. Yes. And I'm not intimidated by any man, any woman, any source of income. That I am not, period. I've come too far from where I started from. I was here as we were singing the song, Yahshua, Yahshua, how precious is his precious dumb. My heart was just overwhelmed because where do I go from here, Yah? There's nowhere to go but into the kingdom. I've expended all of my youth striving to ascertain the jewels and the gems of Torah. And I will not sell that out for some form of penury. No one is going to give me $1 million. No one. No one is going to give me an estate in California. I would not take it. I would sell it. Use it here. I'm not going to find it in the nickel dime store. The Martins don't give a damn about me, Walmart. We can only find it in Yahshua HaMashiach. So what else is it for me to live for? Tell me. I will be a brazen fool to turn my back on him now. I'm not going to do that. Not for wife, children, sons or daughters. He's thinking about, let me say this that I'm going to teach. When you find the true essence of a man's love, when a man loves you. I thought about that this morning as I'm sitting and looking at Dora and my Isha, sitting in preparation for the service. And I thought that if I have to tell her every day I love her, if she doesn't know I love her, my eyes reflect that. My actions, my activities reflect that. My verbiage, my tender embrace. You can tell a lot about one when you embrace them. You can tell the essence of a man with a handshake. That's why most folks don't like to embrace. You like to avoid that. And the Torah commands us to greet one another with a chadosh, kiss. And so she cannot sense, as they would say in my days, the vibes from that. The words will have no value at all. It is the closeness of that embracing when I can lay my head upon her jats and she can lay her head upon me, and the fragrance of her that are known only to these nostrils here, that's more valuable than this phony lie. The folks tell everybody they love them every day and the wife kills the husband. The husband kills the wife for insurance. And the wife complains about everything. And the husband is not satisfied. Yeah. They leave the house. I loved you. Nah. He loves me. Hallelujah. And that's all that matters to me. Hallelujah. I don't care if I have one to be a friend. You must understand, because if you're my friend, I've found the jewel. Hallelujah. And that's a fact. That's how determined I am. And that's how he has strengthened me, and he refortifies me daily, because I'm going to trust him until the day ends. And at the end of the day, it's well with me. I can't ask for anything else. I'm not going to live beyond another 60 years. I'm not going to live another 40 years. I'm not going to live another 30 years. Peradventure, I may have 50, maybe 20, who knows? But then those days are much more or less productive. And I'm not going to spend that time of life trying to battle against that which is so wicked and vile. No, sir. I'm going to serve him as I have as a young man. And so as I get old, my days will not be miserable. I can think on the Tov and the excellence of Yah. So I know my days are not as long as they have been. I'm not going to see another 60 plus years. I know that. I'm not going to see another 40 plus years. I'm not going to see another 30 plus years. I may be alive, but those days are spent in agony and you don't even recall the day before. That's a fact. I'm a student of understanding. You'd be surprised if I asked most of us how many women, how many people of her age today. It's not millions. It's not hundreds of thousands. It's a couple hundred thousand. And so don't be silly. Out of 300, 15, 20 million people just here in this nation? There are not that many people her age. There are not that many people her age. When they hit your age, there are not that many people. That's a fact. Well, how do you know? Because I look at things like that. I need to understand things like that. And by the reason of strength, you may pan out another 10. By reason of strength. And that he strengthens you and gives you the the ability to have confidence in him daily. Hallelujah. That's it. So while I live, I think that nothing, I will allow my life to testify of his grandeur, his excellence, the power of life. I'm going to live. And I'm going to live in Yeshua HaMashiach. And that is through the power of that testimony. There is nothing else. Nothing else that is of any substance, of any value, that brings any kind of reward. Now, your young, immature, juvenile mind may tell you that, but you're silly. Silly little boy and a silly little girl. This world is cruel. This is a monstrous world, and it hates you. Especially you that looks like that. And that's a fact. I want to proceed in the teaching that I began some weeks ago and open the door to the insights of the strongholds that we battle against. And the power of the strongholds that you may take so nonchalantly that it is not relevant. And so if I quiz us all, we will tell ourselves that we know what the strongholds are, but we don't. And so I shall proceed to open the door today, because if you did, Yisrael, we will not do the things we do. I want to reintroduce the words of Shaul. They are profound here as he writes, unto the scattered remnant in Corinth, those that were the nature of the Goyim, they had the heathen nature and the heathen attitude like we do today. We want to dress like the heathens. We want to act like the heathens. We want to reveal ourselves like heathens. And so this is the mindset that Shaul was dealing with, where even one would have his father's wife. It's in the book. You think that that doesn't happen today? And so We have drawn to the heathen ways. We allow that to be procreated in our children. They become more heathenistic than you. I would often say to those that, even in my ignorance, I say, now as we develop this knowledge of truth, you turn your back, your children are going to do things you would never ponder doing. You look at them that are there. I don't need to know what they're doing. I know what they're doing. It is beyond reproach, vile, sadistic, and evil. It's beyond that. We can take this nonchalantly as though that it is of no value. But I declare unto you the whole counsel as according to this aspect of Almighty Yah this day. So that's all you need for today, this counsel. Shaul writes unto nation of the people of Yah. He writes in 2 Corinthians in chapter 10 and verse 3. He identifies the characteristic of our walk. We walk in the flesh, or our halach, the derech that we take. It is according to the principles and the applications of our nature. It is our nature that commands us to get angry, to get upset, to do that one wrong, pretend you love this one. So although we walk according or in the flesh, in the barasa, the basa, this buzzardry nature, because a buzzard will eat anything, and we will eat the decaying rubbish of the world. He says, we do not milchama, our battle, our force, our tenacity, our ability to be skillful in battle. He said, our fight is not after the nature of what we see according to our carnal fleshly ways. He instructs us that the keli, the weapons, the instruments, and the keli is more than a sort of shotgun, a 45 magnum. It is more than a bow and arrow, but it is the way we dress our minds. It is the clothing of one, the way one dress, the way one carries oneself. This is our weapon now. I was saying to one the other day, I can go in the midst of the ghettos, and I'm not worried about anyone messing with me. Why? Because I know how, what kind of mind they're dressed in. And I know how to address the minds of those. I would have no problem at all. Believe me. But there are those that couldn't do that. He says, so the weapons of our warfare or our Sabbath, that is a command of Yah that we are set for a defense of the Torah of Yahshua HaMashiach. And so the Sabbath is that we go forth to battle. We are here to defend. We're here to defend our mother, Yerushalayim, which is up from above, which all things are birthed by her. So we're set to defend our mother. Tell me what man will not defend his mother? Tell me. I recall my days living in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. There was a man, he was older than me, probably 5-6 years older. His mother was a notorious drunkard. His name was Chase. If I've ever met a man during those days of my life that truly loved me, he took me under his bosom as a young brother. He never had a brother, but his mother was a drunkard. He was a hardworking man. He spread the mud. Stucco. He did that. And even then he was making, what, $15 an hour? That was in the early 70s. She was a drunkard. And I would watch that man, his mother stumbling down the street, barefooted, drunkard. I watch him, how he would grab her and embrace her. How he loved that woman. He was a man's man too. He was not a boy. So he embraced me as his young brother. And believe me, he came from a family of cousins. They were notorious there in Southwest 6th Street in that day. And they were gigantuous of men too. And everybody knew that they would hurt you. And he was no pushover. I'm showing you this, how this man would protect her. And if you touch one of them, you might as well touch all of them, because they are coming to get you. And he embraced me. He would say to me, don't go around them. You stay away from them. He was not a drunkard, but his mother was. I don't think Chase ever knew his father. If it's one person I would want to see in life, it would be him. I would. Nobody embraced me, brought me into their bosom. He did. I often think about him. I really do. And I would listen to him. And he would rebuke me and get on me like a little brother. I didn't fight him. I didn't disobey him. Because he was loyal to me until the day I left that state unto the end. So our battle, the weapons, the keli of our Sabbath, our service, to go out to battle and war for Yah. They are not carnal. We must. So any kind of application that draws us and directs us And that it is facilitated by our own natural proclivity, our desire. You know that it is not from Yah. We must be led by the Ruach HaKodesh. We must be led by the mind and the principles of Yahshua HaMashiach. For we have that mind. Mother Ruach, we must be led. And to lead, you must have the guidance, the prudence, the wisdom of one that has gone that way and know every kind of stronghold, every kind of delusion that is in that way. And only he knows that. Can you tell me about death? He can. Only he knows that. He lets us know that, but it is Gibor. It is mighty. It is strong. It is tenacious because of its tenacity to stand up against every power of darkness. It has gone down into the bellows of hell and caused the nakedness of Hashatan and the shadims of darkness to be exposed to say that you have no power over death, nor life, for the elected ones of Almighty Yahweh. But we have the power through the strong, powerful greatness of Yah. It is mighty through, only through. We must come in at the gate. We must be gone at the better sheet of all things. And we must go out through Gileana. We must go through. But they are mighty through. It is the process to enter and to finish. It is the process of entering and finishing. It is the process of the beginning and the chit, the end. But they are mighty through. In the midst of great death, you trust him. At the end of death, you trust him. And you overcome the power and the sting of death, Yisrael. The mighty through who? Through Almighty Yahweh. To the pulling down, to the dismantling of the stronghold, the matsuds, the matsud, that defense, that city that is built to defy the Torah of Yah, that refuge that you run into when the Torah of Yah strikes a dart through your heart. But the Masud consists of more than that. I will tell you the principle of that. It is a particular. It is a particular belief and an attitude that one has. That's the power. That is the Masud. It is my attitude. It is my belief. No one is going to tell me. Even when you're wrong, you don't want to be told. No one is going to show me. That is the Masud. That is the stronghold. And I want to show you the principles. They are not even principles. It's an attitude that we believe that we are right when we are absolutely wrong. No one is going to convince you you're wrong. It's a state of mind that is the most powerful thing. And it is controlled by not your own will, but there's a force that contends against Yah every day to bring you into that delusion, to cause you to deny the power of Torah. And you began to speak accolades to your own mind. You think because you've talked back or said something, you think you're smarter. I got her, I got them. I showed them the woman I am. You're not a woman. I showed them the man. I'm just as strong as you. I'm a man like you. I've had many to tell me that. I'm a man like you. I said, then you're not worth a damn if you're a man like me. You would have to see the expression when I say that. How much of a man is you? I said, well, then you're not worth a damn thing then. You have nothing if you are a man like me. For all flesh is as grass, all flesh. I said, you have no value at all. I said, well, I'm striving to be like the man Yahshua is. I stopped them cold in their tracks. They don't even know how to respond with that. Which way do they go?
So undoubtedly you classify me as a man. Uh-huh.
They don't know which way to go. They don't know how to handle that. The strongholds. The strongholds. The strongholds. What are they? What are the matsuits? What is this attitude? And what I believe that I am right. You're wrong, my friend. You're not right. Unless your mind is fashioned with the love of this book, you're delusional. Unless you present the love that this book talks about, you are delusional and you're controlled by some of the most devious powers of hell. One thinks because one does something that is right for the moment that that makes them a champion. You're not a champion. You're not a champion. Because I gave you a candy bar, that doesn't make you kind. I gave you some of my potato chip, that doesn't make you nice. Children do that. That's not the kindness of Yah. That's not the Yahweh of Yah. We're going to deal with the strongholds today, though. They must be brought down. There's nothing that exudes you greater than this. Your liba, your liba, your lab, nothing. You don't even see your corruption and your sins. You don't see how vile and repugnant you are. You don't see how you defy Almighty Yahweh, but you got a justification of your own ways. We're going to deal with the strongholds. It is one thing I want to show you every order of the stronghold, and you will know that it brought you on the captivity, because there's one sure sign that you're under the bondage and the captivity of that stronghold. I'm going to break it down. I'm going to make it simple. That not even a knot is going to escape. No one shall escape. No one at all. Yisrael. We're not going to be brought under the power of these strongholds, Yisrael. Man as wise as Shlomo says that a fool's mouth is his destruction. That's what destroys a fool, Yisrael. And his lips, they are the matsu, they are the snare and the stronghold of that man. That is what brings a man down, his own lips. But then why does or why do the lips of a man bring him down? Because the issues that flows through one self, it comes from one's heart. It comes from the stronghold of one's mind. It comes from their own belief, their own attitude, and what they call principles that not even worth dog's dung. There's only one right way, and that's the way Yahshua is the way. That's the way of truth. There's no other way, Yisrael, no other way at all. Let me read this quickly. We're going to proceed here. The writings of Nahum. This is a sure confidence for you, and I want you to grasp this and to lay hold. Nahum chapter 1 and verse 7. The Nobi of Yah says that Almighty Yahweh, he is tough, he is excellent. He is great. He is magnificent. He is mighty. He's a friend. He is tov, and he is a stronghold. Do you understand? Yah is a stronghold in the day of Sarah, in the day of tribulations and great trials and affliction. He is a stronghold. He is the place whereby we are refortified. He is our refuge that we enter into to the mind of Yah by this book. You're not going to enter into Yah's mind by some delusional, wicked practices that your attitude and your belief has conjured up. He is tough. In the day of great Sarah and the great of trouble, he is tough. He is a stronghold in the day of trouble. And then this is great for us. And not only that, and he, Yahweh, and he knows. He yada. He has experience. There has been a relationship. As a young man, Evangelist Hartsfield taught me one thing. I said, well, I know at that time, I believe it was President Carter or whomever it was, I can't remember. He looks at me, he says, you don't know him. But his name is President Jimmy Carter. He said, you don't know him. You know of him, but you don't know him, my friend. When you know someone, there is a relationship, there's an experience there. As the world would say, well, we got to get to know each other. You've never heard that? Girl, I got to get to know you. Women are known for that. Men generally don't use those kinds of expressions. Men are very observant. Observation, watch. They see the little signs. Women like to talk and prior into business. They got to know this and know that. Men don't tend to do that. There's never been one man that can say that I prior to, I don't give a damn about what they did in the past. There are those that have said I have, but you're wrong. There are those that have been with me all for many years. I've never done that. I've never asked questions because I don't care. I don't care. That's why I don't allow people to tell me their history. Hold up. I don't need to know that because many times people think that their lives are much more spectacular and they have been tried by things than anyone else. I say, everyone can testify to that. Yeah? You're not saying anything. So what's the difference? You a dog, you did that. Stop that. I don't want to hear that. I don't want to hear that. Who hasn't? That didn't know Yah. And he knows them that trust him. You can say you trust him all you want to, but it means nothing at all. Those that have confidence, they have the strength of Botach Imuna. They cry on me because they are faithful, they have confidence, and they are sure. That's why you cry on me. Because you know that he is that way. But to those that trust him and yada him, he is a stronghold. A stronghold is to defend you, keep you in, that nothing gets to you, nothing overpowers you, nothing subdue you. That's what a stronghold is. And I'd rather be in that stronghold. I'd rather walk in the principles of Yah. And my attitude and my belief be shaped by Torah, then for my corrupt, vile, sadistic, evil ways have been formed and orchestrated by lies and falsehood and those things that are fictitious. That I've lied to myself enough that I literally believe my lies. There are people that have lied to themselves so they literally believe their lies. There's those that have lied to themselves to think they're sweet, and you're not sweet. There are men that lie to themselves, I'm kind and I'm nice to everyone. You are a flat-out liar. You judge yourself, my friends, the stronghold. The strongholds. God, may I reintroduce what I read, just listen, out of the book of 1 Maccabees, or the Maccabees. One verse I want to read. As we express when those on the, when they began to put their crowns upon themselves, and they began to relish in their own knowledge. We have that today, don't we? The sons of Antiochus, everyone has a crown. Everyone knows today. Everyone has that knowledge in their understanding of everything. When they began to do that, the land became even corrupt. And so in their defiance, they said, we're going to take the city of Dawid. And this is what they did. It says, and they built Maccabeum, 1 Maccabeum, chapter 1, verse 33. And they built there the city of Dawid with a great strong wall. Masuds, a strong tower. And they built mighty towers there and made it a stronghold. They made it a stronghold. You have made yourself a stronghold. My grandmother would say, he's a strong-willed little devil. And she would take the rod and drive that spirit off. Strong-willed it. And they made a stronghold for them. And this is the catalyst here. This is what alters everything here in verse 34. And they put therein a sinful, wicked, deplorable nation, the wicked men. And they made themselves strong. They fortified themselves therein. And that's what we do. We build the towers of our wall. I am I. Me, myself, and I. It's me. It is mine. It is I. You build the towers of your repugnant, wicked ways, your vile nature. You become strong. And don't let someone defy that. Let someone tell you you're wrong and you're wicked. You're ready for battle. There's one thing as a young Igor man I would hate when folks, I love everybody. I would say, you don't love everyone. I say, prove it. You think you in your fine house, what you call fine, you're going to go get a derelict out there and bring him in, bathe him and feed him in? I say, you're a liar. Yeah. You're liars. Yeah. You don't even know how to love you. If you don't know how to love you, you don't know how to love anyone. You commands us to love our neighbors as we love ourselves. I've never said that. I knew it was a lie. I have the challenge of loving her. Challenge of loving him. Challenge of loving him. Don't give me those lies. You can see that your self-indignant righteousness, but it's like a filthy nida rag from a woman. It has no value. So help me, Yah, to love. Teach me how to love, Yah. Show me your kindness. This is what the whore has taught you and us. And so these men, they fortified themselves in there. These men said that we're strong. You say, I'm strong. And that's what people say today. I'm strong. I'm a strong man. They would say that in my days. Strong man. You're weak man. Because a strong man knows he's strong. He knows that. He does things. He has watched men for years doing things. He comes along and he can do it. He knows what is right to do. He understands the principles of righteousness. He knows how. He learns by watching. He doesn't run his mouth. He learns by watching. So they built a sinful nation there. Look at Yah. They built them and they fortified themselves there in that place. And so once you fortify yourself and you take your stance, no one is going to tell you, not even Yah. This is what Yah did. This, I want to show us something, then I want to show you that mindset. And Ezra gives us a knowledge of this roots in man. 4th Ezra, chapter 3, one verse. We must be grounded and rooted in a Havan. Because if you're not grounded and rooted in love, then everything that comes out of you, you're going to be grounded and rooted in hypocrisy and lies. We must be grounded and rooted. The tentacles of the roots must dig down into the ground. We must be a towering behemoth. I watched the Achim of the morning. Things fascinate me. I watched them take down that tree. You could hear the pieces fall to the ground as Zachin thundering and it thuds. Boom. Ouch. It's eerily frightening. And I said, yeah, I see why you're so extremely careful and watchful, and everybody's watching. We don't give a damn for each other. That's why we don't watch out for each other. And I watched and I stood back. I said, don't worry about that, we'll get that. But that alone was enough for me just to see the excellence, the strength. It takes something to build and to take down. And I watched my sucking proliferated with sweat, wet as someone poured a bucket of water on him. We're not willing to be tried that way. There's a reason why. Ezra said they have formed their refuge of defense in their minds. And he said this is what Yah did because of that. 4 Ezra 3:20. And yet Almighty Yahweh did not take away from them their evil, their ra, their sadistic hearts. He did not take away the evil laugh. He did not. He did not take it away. That's why Yahshua commanded you're going to die in your sins. He did not take away their evil hearts. Why? So that his Torah, your Torah, might bring forth fruit in them. You don't have the fruit that Shaul instructs us as the fruit of the Ruach, you're flat out liar. I don't care how you pretend. You can be pretentious and false to yourself. And you can allow that stronghold of hell, those are shardims, they are demons and devils that operate in your mind. Yah did not take that evil heart out of them. He left it there. Well, you can't say that, man. It's one thing that an evil heart, this Novi, as he spoke, it has to be refined through revelation of experience of prophets after him to speak to us. Well, there is one that spoke and lets us know these men, how they operate, and their stronghold that they defy Yah. Quickly, Revelation Gilyona. This is the attitude. That's what Matsud is. It is an attitude that one has and one's belief. Revelation chapter 9 and verse 20. Revelation 9 and verse 20. He talks about this attitude of the men that your Bovel or your Babel, it has come down. Your kingdom that you rely upon, it is one of confusion. It doesn't plant the fruit of principles in your mind. He talks about a kingdom that has fallen. Everything that you relied upon has fallen. And he speaks of the identity of these men that Ezra talked about in Revelation chapter 9, verse 20. He talks about these men, that the rest of these men, which were not killed by the plagues, yet repented not. We don't make teshuvah. We don't shoo. We don't turn. The power of that stronghold, it doesn't allow you to turn from your sadistic and your evil ways. You can counsel all day. It's almost like a mother in the weeping of her heart trying to counsel her daughter and her father, his son, and they're defiant, and they're going to show him every reason why they should continue in the way. And they won't change their attitude and their ways. Yah says, although they see my hand, what hand? Well, we haven't seen this structure. We have seen the hand of Yah in the power of Yahshua HaMashiach. What is greater than that? And these men, those that Yah did not take the evil heart out of, they will never shuv, they will never make teshuvah, they will not repent, what? Of the works of their hands, what things they fashion in their mind, their lies, that they shall not worship demons or shardims and devils, and give their minds over unto the demonic construct. Overwhelmed by the things that the world present to them. They love the charge of demonic powers. They should not worship devils or idols.
And everybody got to have them little gold today, don't they? You know, the gold rims, the gold which they think is of value. It is of no value at all. They won't repent of worshiping their cars and their houses and their things and their clothing and stones and wood, which can neither see all the cars in the world can't see. I recall one of the basketball players, he made a statement. One went and bought a Maybach Mercedes-Benz, $350,000. And so the basketball player that made the statement, he was just as wealthy as the one that bought the car. He said, I want to ask you one question. He said, tell me what that thing does. Does it talk to you? Does it drive you? Does it open the doors for you? He said, tell me, $350,000? He said, I want to know what that thing does. He watched one of the most prominent preachers in Charlotte. He buys and leases a Maybach and all that. And he spent the last 7 years in prison too. See, that Maybach is not going to say, we're going to bail you out. We'll pay the government their money. And these are the things, Yisrael. They're not going to repent. He's not going to repent because he loved the Maybach. Something is twisted in your mind. When you love a house, you spend more time in a house and a car, and you love that, and you got to have this, then you love having the life of Yah. Something is wrong in you. Something is twisted. You don't even have a demon mindset. These things cannot see, they can't hear, and nor can they walk. The Maybach is not going to move from that one spot unless you find out. It's not going to move at all. And then he says in verse 21, neither repented they of their murders. For if a man hates his brother or his sister, he despised them without any cause, you are a murderer. For you despise not wanting my fellowship. When you despise not wanting to embrace me, man, and greet me as a man. Come on, daughter, when you despise not embracing your sisterhood. Come on, something is twisted in your mind. Something is wrong in your logics. It says, neither repented they of their murder. They will kill you. They will destroy you. They will try to assassinate your character. They will do anything, but that's all right. Neither, he said, of their sorceries. I will deal with this a little later on. Neither of their fornication, and they certainly are not going to say that I'm a thief. The thief cometh not but to rob, steal, and to destroy. And that spirit, it doesn't care. It frankly doesn't give a darn. And that's the nature of Shadim and the powers of darkness. We think that Bobel, let America be Babel in the sense of many of these little juveniles here. It is more than Babel. It is a mindset. It is an attitude. It is a concept of belief that one defies Yah. When you call upon your lying, devilish Jesus, that lie, when you hear the truth and you don't repent of it, you're calling upon a lie. Yah is not a part of the God clan. He is the Almighty One. They are gods. He is in a different class. All by himself. Nor the class with him. He doesn't share that with no one else and nobody. So I say this for the attitude of those. Let this nation be Babylon, Babel, Babel, the place of confusion. They will all tell you she has fallen. And she has fallen from the day that Yah brought Babel down. She has never been reconstituted in the physical sense of locale. She has never, never. But her tentacles and those that were captains of her guard, the Shadims and the demons and the powers of hell, they are spreading their tentacles throughout the Olam, throughout the earth. Same prophet now, he speaks unto us, Revelation chapter, hallelujah, 18. That's why you hear the cry today. The battle has begun. The stronghold has mounted its offense. Revelation chapter 18, I want to read verse 2 here quickly. Yohanan said, he saw this proclamation and the cries of one. He was not talking about a physical city that stands, but he was talking about this mythical power. Everything that we associate with that which is mythical, it is delusional, isn't it? It changes, just like a magician. The sleight of hands. It's not that he's making anything disappear. He tells you to make the sleight of hands. And that's what confusion does. Well, I thought it was that. I thought it said that. No, it didn't say that. He said, I heard the cry of the Melech. Revelation 18:2. And he cried mightily like a Gabor. Strong one. He was the Melech. The messenger sent by Yah, he cried mightily with a strong, with the essence of whom he was, a strong voice. He sang, Babel, Babylon, the great, is Nathan. She has fallen. She has come down to desolate, down to the dungeons of hell. She has fallen. Now, if America is fallen, let her be Baba, Bobel, or Babel, or Babel. It says, and she has become the habitation, the dwelling place of Shadim, every kind of demon, every kind of vile, insidious wickedness, every kind of corrupt thing that is beyond comprehension. No order to a woman today, no order to a man. Effeminality, Yah is going to kill every effeminate man. He hates all effeminate men. They have blurred the gender dress that the men and the boys, I tell you, women don't even wear pants as tight as them. They're more effeminate than their mamas. And the mamas have taught them to be effeminates. She has taught them her ways. She defies the man. And the Torah commands you, daughters, to obey your man, submit. Subject yourself unto him like you do Yah. Don't tell me you love Yah. You are fed out, filthy liar. And in that, by your honoring him, he will learn. He may not know how to. I had to learn how to love. I had to watch men and see how they loved. One of the things that I learned early when I first got married, her father-in-law was a wicked coward, a stepfather-in-law. A stepfather, that's the proper. He was not even that dirty dog. And because of her, I kind of honored him. And he was a crude individual. You don't want me to eat at their house? I said, no, I will eat all that Mother Ema Smith cooks for me. She cooked 10 chickens. I'm going to try to eat all of them. Don't invite me to your house and tell me to eat. And you're going to ration it out to me? You will not do me like that. So he had been to prison. He thought he was all this tough cat, but I was fit as a fiddle then. I was strong and fit. Yeah, I was too. And so he calls himself one day, my ignorance, he's going to jack me up. When he did that, he messed up. I didn't hit him, didn't have to. But from that moment on, he realized, this is not a little boy that I'm playing with. But I watched the dog do something one day that blew me away. I watched him come home to his, he wasn't a husband, but to her mother. And I saw this beautiful bouquet of roses, and I'm like, my, my. I knew it was right to do that. I was making $2.65 an hour when I got married. That's not a lot of money. But I knew we had a forest across the street, even back then, on West Boulevard. I couldn't buy 12. Because it would have taken too much of my money. I remember Mother buying one that day.
Running up the hill to my apartment in Little Vance, it cost me $3.50 back then. That was a lot of scratch.
And I'll never forget that how right I knew it was. There was this woman that, the man that lived with her, we went to school together. And he was big time in a certain market. So when I ran up the hill to the house with that one rose, this woman didn't even know, quote, what love was. She said, "That's for someone special." It was only one, it wasn't twin. She says, "I know someone is going to be happy with that." And I knew then, see, those were the initial principles to understand care, to understand the importance of that. And to go from there to understand the greatness of his beauty and his love. He has given me the rose of Sharon, something greater than a rose. He has given me Yeshua HaMashiach. Hallelujah. And so the messenger cried out that what you rely upon, it is fallen. It's down. It has become the habitation of demons and devils. Now look what it says here. It says has become the whole. It has become the abiding place of what? Pich gul. Of every foul spirit. And every unclean spirit and every kind of hateful demonic power there is, it has become that. That's what this generation is. It's a powerful stronghold. Well, I was brought up this way. Well, Jezebel, woe to you. I don't hide anything. Can I tell us this? And I will deal with that pichul, that foul spirits. I want to open the door to that. My natural sister, she'll call every now and then. I don't like dealing with her because she's a fruitcake. So she calls, and I don't know how long ago it was. I returned the call. So she says to me, "I would like to come home and visit." She lives in New Orleans. "I would like to come home for revival start the second week of August. If I had $1 million, I wouldn't send you a dime, Cal. Let me tell you the little story. I like to come home the second week of August and go down to revival. I come home every year this time. I just don't have the money." I said to her, "I wouldn't send you one nickel to come home for revival." "Why?" I said, "I would not send you a dime to come home. Not one penny." I said, "You think, now here you are, woman. You think I would send you money to come home and to visit for some kind of..." I said, "If you had said to me, 'Can I come see you? And you just teach me a little bit.' I said, you think I would send you some money to come home to a nasty whole house?" I said, "If I had money," and I didn't have money, "I would not send you a nickel to come home." "Well, you know, that's the only time I plan to come." I said, "Well, that's your problem. Don't try to tell me your problem." "Well, you know," I said, "woman, you shut your wicked mouth. You shut your mouth now." That's how I talk. She was there. And then I proceeded to show how ignorant, how stupid, how dumb you are. You have no sense. You don't even know how to love, woman. Only you out there. There's not even anything that is decent would even touch you. You think she rose up at me? She got quiet. I didn't even know if she was there. "You still there?" "Yeah, I'm still here." I said, "That's it. I'm not messing with you, crazy woman. Bye." "You tell me to be quiet, then you tell me bye." I said, "Bye. And I will not deal with you. I won't deal with a fool like that." "You can. But that's your sister." "Well, who is my brother? Who is my sister? They that hear, and they that hear the Torah of Yonder, and that Asa that do his chafetz. That's my brother. That's my sister. That's my family." "That Jezebel down there is not my family. And I tell her what she is." See, that's love.
You damn hypocrites can't do that because you know there's something in you that cannot be honest. I am. And I guarantee you, she'll probably call me again. She'll be just as humble as they come. I'll just call you. You better call me like that because you're not going to raise your voice at me. You're not going to even talk to me that way. You can with them, but not with me, my friend. You're not going to do that to me. Hallelujah. You're not going to do that. Period. I'm not going to abuse you, but you're not going to abuse me. Hear this. It has become the habitation of every unclean, every vile thing, and every foul spirit. I want to give us and show you what a foul spirit is. I want to give us some demonstrations of that. But I want you to hear this and turn quickly into Yeshaya, Isaiah. I want to show you Yisrael. I'm a student of this book. I don't read it. I study. And I will know that I'm approved of Yah when I come away with a plethora of simple truth that is revealed so easily to me. Not that I'm a scholar, a bright, intelligent man, that I'm not. And I will not lie to myself, but I am a man. I am an ish. I like that better than man because I'm an ish. Shaped in the character and the form and the similitude of Yah. I like that. That's what an ish is. Mad is a dramatic word. But I like the word ish, all right? It says here in Isaiah chapter 65. Now listen to this verse 1. 7 verses I want to read. Yah says, I am salt. I am salt of them that ask not for me. Yah says, I am sought after by those. We see the examples with Yahshua. Master, my servant needs healing. Yeah. I'm not even worthy that you should enter into my house. Just speak the words that he may be healed. It says, I'm sought of them that ask not for me. I'm found of them that sought me not. You don't know how to seek Yah. No more you know how to seek the treasures, the riches of Torah. He said, unto a nation that was not called by my name. And we are a nation, although we are called by his name. The nation of Yisrael, the Hebraic lineage, it is a scattered nation. It doesn't call on the name of Yah. It's into every kind of God worship there is. He said, they don't even call on my name, but that's all right. Yah says, I have spread out my hands all the day. To who? We love him. He calls us a rebellious people, which walk in a way that is not tough. Don't you walk in your own rights or principles? Yes. You can't tell me I know I'm right. Don't you walk in that stronghold? Yes. There are many marriages today that have been dismantled because of that stronghold. You can't tell me. No. I've always listened to my wife, but I'm the arbiter. What I say, that's it. If we have to go sleep in the woods, we'll sleep. You know you're going to follow me, woman. Stop it. Period. She will. After their own thoughts, your own stronghold, your own stronghold, your own matsud. See, that's what a stronghold is. It's one what one thinks of one's own, quote, principles that they hold fast to. One's own attitude or one's own belief. Well, how do you know that? Well, through different resources of searching out words that I may understand the etymology and the origin, understand the principle of that word. There are many things hidden in Torah. You can't just read this one verse and think you can just pick verses and understand this. You got to understand the depth of this in order. You got to look at every word, spread. What does Yah mean when he spread? When he spread out, what? His yad, his hands. He said, what? Not some of the day, but Yom Kippur. He said, all the day, and they did not, and that which was tav, but they walked after their own matsuds, their own thoughts, their own ideas, their own ideology.
He said, a people that provoke me to wrath. Now, you will never think you provoked him to anger sometime. But he says continuously to my face, you are, that's a brazen bold statement. That's why we can see those in Revelation. We will deal with this. They will not repent. They say, show me my wrong. You've never said that. Well, what did I do wrong? Tell me what I did wrong. Show me my sin. Oh, you get quiet on me, but that's all right. How did I do him wrong? Well, I did her wrong. Show me. I shall. There's one thing about this ill, twisted, demonic stronghold of your own mind. You will never see your lies, your corruption, your sins. And they have a strong, powerful hold on you. You can't break free. For whom the Son makes free is free. I'm glad he has made me over. I don't want to be the man, the boy I was when I was 21, 25, 35, 45, 55. Even when I was 59, I don't want to be that little boy. I want to be a man. I want to be an oosh. We have provoked him to anger continuously. Now that's a bold statement. He said, to my face. You have gone under every great tree. You have offered up unto every kind of dog of hell, every kind of god. Listen to what he says. He said that you even offer a sacrifice in the gardens. I will show you what we have sacrificed. We're going to show you how this power, this stronghold, you need a powerful weapon to break loose from that. He said, you have offered up sacrifices in the gardens, and you burn incense upon the altars of your brick. You burn, as they would say, you burn in that late night oil, aren't you? That was the cliche in my days. When one was always going and doing, they would say, you're burning that late night oil. They were speaking Torah. You're offering up the sin offerings to hell, man. When the last time you had some sleep, they went day and night. Didn't get no sleep. None whatsoever, no rest. I got some beautiful rest last night. I was tired. I found myself when the Achim were all in. I said, okay, now. Joachim, better me, you got that gate? Yeah, and I found myself going out 5 minutes at a time. What? I'm thinking this sun is coming up. That's tired there. And so I wake up and read a little and had the scriptures open, look at that. And, 5 minutes. And so I saw I'm looking, where's Raphael? The light's off. No, that's it. She must be in bed. I'm glad. Well, about 8:25, 8:20, that was it. I didn't have to lay that long before the lights went out. And I was gone. I was gone, gone, gone. And didn't wake up to 5 a.m. this morning. And now it's time to get up. I feel refreshed. Yeah. So they have burned the incense upon the altars of brick, which remain among the graves. They live among the dead, and they lodge in the mountains. And this is it right here. This is the pigula. He says, which eat swine flesh and broth of the pigul, of the abominable. You take every kind of unclean thing, buzzard feet, and rabbit's guts, and crow ears, every kind of unclean thing, and lion's urine, and all of that, just to show you the compilation of this filth, your lies, your thoughts, your attitude, your spirit. He said, and they have drinking the broth of the abominable, not thing as the swine, but plural, the things in their vessels. You have made a concoction that is more death than death itself. And they have not been created outside according to the externals. It has been created here. They have taken everything that is vile, pig's dung, rabbit guts, crow's guts, catfish dumplings, and they made a broth out of it to soothe them. You drink a nice broth in the winter, you got a cold, chicken broth, it helps you, doesn't it? Is this what solidified their ways, the broth of this pichgul? This pichgul, the stronghold that is vile and nasty and filthy, things in their vessels, which say, look what it says, stand by thyself. I don't need nobody to stand with me. Come not near to me, for I'm more righteous than you. There are those that segregate themselves and think that they're more righteous. And they're all standish. That's wicked. I'm glad this preacher's preaching today. I can get blessed. So they talk like that. That's how they talk. I'm greater than you, Yah. I'm much more chadosh. I'm more set apart than you. He said, these are a smoke in my nostril. This is what they feed me. A fire that burns all day and night. He said, I want you to understand it is written before me. I will not keep silent, but will repay. I'm going to recompense. But I will recompense. Even I'm going to recompense according to your bosom what things you hold dear to your heart. That's how I'm going to repay. I want you to hold it in your mind. I want you to keep that stronghold. Because baby girl, baby boy, when I come, I'm going to pay you what you deserve. Your gift will be just what's in you. He says, I'm going to repay you according to what's in your bosom. In your labor, in your mind. He said, that's how I'm going to pay you. Then he says, you're ovine. What is ovine, ovon? What is iniquity? It is filthy, perverse, demonic. He said, your iniquity and the iniquity of your fathers together. As Granny would say, no, I'm getting you for what you did today. But I'm going to get you for what you did the other day. And remember last week when I told you I was going to get you, but I didn't get you because, and I'm going to get you for that too, and I'm going to get you for that, and I'm going to get you for the other day, I'm going to get you for this today. I'm combining it all. I had patience with you. I tried to be kind to you. You thought you could get by. You thought you could do your own way. Then I let you get by with that. I let you get by. You remember that, baby? You remember that, honey? Yeah, man, I remember. And she didn't hold back any kindness. She didn't spare me from crying. He says, I'm going to pay you for both of it all together, saith Yah, which have burned your incense upon the mountain. Baby, he's burning his all day and night. Man, you burning that all, man. When you get sleep? And that's what we're doing. Just like the foolish virgins, we think we're pure. We hear the cry of the one that masters the directions of Yah. We cry for someone to give us oil. You that are wise, I will say, nay, nay. Yeah. You come pray with me. No, it's late in the morning. It's time to get up. Your shoe is coming. Yeah. That's a fact. Yeah. We don't think Yah says, I'm going to get you for what you did and what your dirty papa did. He curses the children down to the third and fourth generation of the fathers that hate him, that don't love him and teach them the principles of Yah and discipline them according to the Torah of Almighty Yahweh. He hates them. That's why these wicked daddies got a price to pay. Wicked daddies got a price to pay. I don't give a damn who the daddy is. You don't negate truth. You don't harden your wicked heart. He that is often reproves. He hardened his heart and he stiffed his neck. And suddenly destruction come. And Yah says, I'm not going to warn him. You cry when you get sick and when pains overtake you. Well, the wicked woman won't pray even in those days. That's a fact. I don't pray for no man or no woman like that. I don't pray for them. We burn incense upon the mountain, and this is what we do. And blaspheme Yah upon our high state of mind. Upon the hill, therefore, I will measure. Hear this, Yisrael. He's going to measure their former work into their bosom. He said, you're not getting by. He said, I'm not letting that get past. Oh, I know if we believe and we make teshuva, he casts our sins as far as away as the east from the west. But when you don't, when you become so strong in your will,
When you become so determined, you cannot correct the fool in this generation. You correct Musa, correct a fool, you will get yourself a blot, man. You correct any wise man, he's going to love you. You correct a wise daughter, she will love you. Sure she will. You correct a foolish daughter, what did I do? Tell me. I'm not that bad. Well, look at what you call dear. Oh, you all might as well say hallelujah. I wasn't born yesterday, and I've been around longer than most of you all, okay? So I wasn't born yesterday. I've been around a little while. I've preached for a long time. And I've dealt with all kinds of folks. I've gone into whole houses, and they love me when I come, and they hate me when I leave. I've gone into places nobody greets me. But that's all right. I remember one of the last places Achim Benjamin and I and a few of those with us went to Gastonia and preached up there one Shabbat evening. And the old man detested me from that day. He was an old man. He said he loved me and cared for me and appreciated me. There are a few old men today that react the way you say it, but they don't love me. They love me in verbiage. But they don't love me. They don't love me. I will not go to their places and preach. I've been to their places and preach, and everyone turned against me. Their sons and their daughters and daughter-in-laws and the whole congregation. Last time I was with one woman, my Israel sister, she said, Winnie's going to sit down. They don't like for me to talk. Hallelujah. They don't like when I talk. Because I deal with honesty and truthfulness. That it may refine me. The husbandman must be the partaker first. I despise a man trying to rebuke me when the light of that is not shining in his life. I hate that. Now, man, don't come that way with me. Don't do me like that. Hallelujah. Can I proceed a little farther? We're going to be all right. Hallelujah. All right. Let me continue here, Yisra'i. This mind of ours have become the inhabitant of every kind of foul spirit, everything that is demonic, everything that is unclean. Yohanan said in Revelation that it has become the habitation, the dwelling place of every kind of shadim, every kind of demon. We don't buy that, do we? I want to show something in Dibarim, Deuteronomy chapter 32. And tell me that this is not taking place today. Even in our lives, Devarim chapter 32, verse 17, he talks about his nation. Again, he said, and they sacrifice to Shadim. Shadim. Devarim, Deuteronomy 32, 17, they sacrifice to devils. They give their children to demons. They give their children under the control of those that are vile, repugnant, and wicked. They trust some of the most violent individuals with their children. This morning, I don't read news. I may read a paragraph. I understand the logistics of everything in that. I can tell you what the story says without reading anymore. And here this man, a doctor, free credit there in California. He's bringing the women in that are poor, raping them. Putting them to sleep. We trust these damn devils and dogs. We don't have no confidence to pray. We don't cry out to Yah. Because we're wicked. And these devils, he going up in, this devil taking advantage of the women. This one man became a multi-millionaire. His house was, he was making $45 million a year. He was a doctor. Putting the women on every kind of drugs, their babies, and killing them. I saw a picture of his house. I say, man, what are you going to do in there? What are you going to do something that big? That what I got is too big for me. I don't need a bedroom this big. For what? A bedroom 9.5 by 9.5, that's all right. I can almost lay across the bed and stretch out that bad boy. I got long arms.
I can almost crisscross the whole bit. Yeah, I got that much room on one side. Roughly, I got that much. That's all right. It accommodates me well for what all I need to do. And when I dropped in it last night at 8:30, I went to sleep. Didn't take me long, did it? Not because you were gone, too. Don't. All right, then. It didn't take me long. It didn't take me 5 minutes. It did not. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. They have sacrificed to devils and not to Yah. We don't give Yah the Zabach. Hell, we don't even know how to praise him. Let's get real. Whoa, I praise Yahweh. I praise my Abba. I'm so real with my attitude toward Yahweh. Yes, I am. I'm not ashamed. No, I'm not. For what? Of this wicked world, you think I would be ashamed of someone that is staunch and wicked and hard toward Yah? Nah, I don't tell you to do it because that's what I do. Hallelujah. He says, they have sacrificed the devils to gods. They don't even know them. Let me show you. They trust dogs that they don't even know. They trust movie stars and singers and fashion designers. They don't even know. I said, I can see shirts for a dollar all day. I don't care. With some other man, I said, why would I wear something? You think I would promote some other devil? I don't buy nothing like that. There's nothing I get that I don't cut every tag out of it. I don't wear no designer clothes. I don't wear that. Don't wear it. Period. I look for a cheap pair of slacks. $15, that's nice. $10, that's my range. $7, I can work with that. It says, and they brought up new gods, newly, that even their vat fear not. This is one of the most detrimental things we have done that has caused the stronghold to become rooted in our minds of the rock, the sore, the strong refuge, the tower, that birthed us, brought us out of darkness into the marvelous light. We have been unmindful. Is he on your mind, Yisrael? Or your own thoughts on your mind? Come on, get real. As old folks say, as I keep him on my mind, day and night, who's as I keep him on my mind? Yes, I do. Yes, I keep him. That would go by in those places back then. Everybody get happy. I'm singing that. As keep him on my mind, yes, I day and night. It wasn't about harmonizing. As I keep him on my mind, day and night. As feel all right, cause I got him on my mind. As I was sick last night, but I kept him on my mind. As I woke up this morning with him on my mind. As I feel all right, cause I kept him on my mind. Come on, Israel, this is a polluted generation. Now sing. No, sing. Got him on my mind, day and night I got him. Got him in my thoughts, oh, got him on my mind. Oh, it makes me happy when I think about him. Got him on my mind, got him on my mind. Got him on my mind, got him in my thoughts, got him on my mind, day and night, yes I do, got him on my mind, oh got him on my mind, everything gonna be alright, we're hypocrites, damn hypocrites, when I was in the world I would get up and do it. We don't have no love for Yah. Our arrogance. I learned a lot of things back then as a young boy, five, six. I would just watch folks. I've always had the propensity to watch and look, observe things. I don't know, maybe y'all just put that in me as a young boy. I could understand things, but I understand everything by watching. I can look at things. I don't need to read instructions. I look, and when I finish, I got it. I can watch a man work, and I can do that, what he's doing.
I want to proceed a little farther. How about that? I like that kind of singing. That's all right. Hallelujah. 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 He said that we have become unmindful. And then he said, has forgotten Yah that formed you. We don't forget him, do we? This is the power of that stronghold. We must cast that down through Almighty Yahweh. We've forgotten about the one who has formed us. Because where our minds have become the habitation of every kind of unclean thing, every kind of shadim, every kind of vile demonic force. And our minds, come on, just be honest. We can almost think of correct thought today or something that is cognate and something that is beautiful. Our minds go in every direction and the filth or the things that were. No. So we're in this generation whereby Yah is opening up a plethora of understanding to us. Greater. What we've ever had. Knowledge that's being uncovered now. Wisdom that's giving us direction like never before, Yisrael. Things that we relied upon, they have not produced anything. Now he's bringing us to the fullness of that time because Yahshua is coming. He is coming. We have forgotten Yah. We have become rebellious. We have not allowed his Ruach to fill us. And so we have given ourselves over to the strongholds of demonic powers and the operations of those foul spirits that pigul, that we would drink the broth and the sins of any corruption. We will give our minds a certain entertainment that it should not be Yisrael. There are things that should trouble you in your mind when you hear it and trouble your heart that you cannot give yourself over unto that. And we give us a pattern here of that stronghold of a man. Here in Tehillim, Psalms 106, verse 35. He tells us what we have done. And how we have mingled ourselves with such wicked works. In Psalms, Tehillim 106, verse 35. He said, but you were mingled. You have Arab, you have pledge. We have literally mortgaged our lives on nothing. That's what Arab is. He said, you have mingled among the heathens and you have learned how to do things like the heathens. That's why I said to one, people may think that I'm a misogynist, that I hate women. I love the daughters of Zion. I hate what the world has done to them, to make them stupid, to make them dumb, and they think they understand love and they do not understand love, to rob them of any kind of beauty. And they have learned the way of the world. They have learned from hoish women. You can say what you want. They've learned how to dress. Their attitude has been formed by women. Can I tell us this? I don't say it. I'm honest. What my Israel has on, she made that. She looked fabulous to me. I like that simplicity. I don't care where we go. I watch women of all kind of ethnicity, religious women. I watch how they come. They tell her you're so pretty. And she crippled. Well, hell, that's not pretty. It's beyond that. I watch it too much. I see it. What does she say to you? I see it all, not sometimes. I see it all the time. One young lady last time, she said, you're not dressed alike. Well, we never dress alike. Never. Put on something, she put on something. Okay, well. How are you all today? And I remember as a young man, the truth, son, 25 years old, people have been married 8, 10, 13 years, more than we. And yet those couple marvel at us, say, you all are, it's just so beautiful. You got such image, you got such maturity. They didn't have that. And not any of them are together today. Y'all put something in my heart from day one, period. It wasn't put in there by what I had learned from my forefathers. He put that thing in me. I see it all the time, and I say to myself, they don't realize you made that, do they? Where are you from?
Where are you from? You're not from here. Where are you all from? You're not from this state. Yeah, we're from beyond. That's what the words Hebrew means. Abram, those from beyond. We are from beyond the concept of man. Well, I'm a Hebrew Israelite. You look like a silly little boy. You look like a silly little boy. You know, the Torah even talks about when a man grows locks, they should not be long, anything like that. You know, you look like a silly little boy. Well, I got knowledge. You don't have nothing, woman. You don't even know how to love your children. How you have knowledge? You don't even know how to honor your man. Come on, man. Well, I'm a Hebrew man. You don't even know how to love your woman. How are you a Hebrew? We are from beyond the concept of others. And so you think beauty, you've learned from the heathens what you think is beautiful, but it's not beautiful. It's not attractive. You are so unsure about yourself, you want attention to be drawn to you. I don't care if I'm filthy as they come. When I walk in a place, I don't have to worry about that. You prideful? No. That's a dog to be prideful. I'm just sure who I am. I'm sure. That's it. I'm sure of who I am. That's it. I know I'm the son of Yah. And I walk with that kind of boldness. When the store, this woman there, and lo, she said, "You are so nice." I said, "I don't know about that. You really don't know me. Well, you're always nice to me. Well, what else could, ma'am, could you assist me, please? And when she sees me, she'll always, anything I help you with? Nah, I got it. You're so nice to me." I said, "Well, I don't know about that, ma'am. I don't even look at women." I said, "I don't know about that. Mm-mm. I don't know about that. That Raphael beside me, she may say, well, I don't know." Now, she couldn't say that. She could not say it. Period. We've given up on Yah. We have learned the way, the stronghold of learning the way of the heathens. You don't look to the world to learn the ways of Yah. You don't look to the world, daughters, for your beauty. Trying to dress like some silly little girl or some little boy. You don't look to the world for that. You look to the old mothers that teach you how to dress and carry yourself. It is right. He goes on to say in Tehillim, he said, "If you have learned their works and you have served their idols," and then he used the words mulchash. He said, "You, which were a snare." These things are a snare to you. These are strongholds. This is what baits you and draws you in. He says, "You are a snare to them." That you even do this. He said, "Yes, you have sacrificed your sons and your daughters to devils." You don't train them in the principles of Yah. That's the power of that stronghold. You don't show them how to love and understand the beauty of discipline. You don't do that. You've learned the way of the world so corruptly. You give them over to hell. You give them over to demons. That demon got a stronghold on you. You sacrifice them to the unclean. You give power to the unclean to control them and teach them and show them why you sit on your lazy. I shall. I would love this man. I would be faithful with him. I've always been that way. I would bless him. I would. I give him a cool glass of water every now and then. I would. Yes, I would. They sacrifice. I don't believe that. He said they sacrifice. They offer their sons and their daughters. Babel has fallen. And that's what they're doing today. The daughters are not inspired by you, mother, father. The world inspires them. And this woman that calls me, I said, "Woman, shut your mouth. Be quiet." She got upset because I said, "You and your daughter's a rebellious little heifer, little Jezebel." She writes me this long letter. I won't even read it. So she kept calling me. I don't feel like talking at 8 at night when my foot are aching from standing all day. I don't feel like talking at 9 when my body is aching. I just don't feel like talking. But she harassed me like the woman did to the master. She just kept annoying him. I said, and so I answered. I'm telling you, I got messages on the, I just kept them because I let the brothers hear one day. And so when I finally talked to her, she goes into this, oh, Raah, this and this, my daughter, this and this and this and this and this. I believe a demon has control of me. I don't know what to do. I want your counselors. I sit on the board and I said, I'm not going to counsel you in that. Not one bit, because when I told you about the little heifer, I told you don't put it in school like you did. And the daughter was all right. And now she sends her black magic. She painting her nails black. I said, when I told you that. Well, I didn't want to be about someone. When I invited you to come, when I invited you on trips with our young daughters, that they could have had a friend. When I invited you, when you didn't even have money, I say, don't give me that bullshit thing. I would have sent you money. You haven't given one dime here. You have never given one nickel here, but I would. You come. Don't worry about gas. Don't worry about that. We'll put gas in your car. We will make sure you got money to go back home. And we'll give you food and all of that. I said, when I invited you, you found an excuse for everything. Now, you want me? I said, no, you go to him. The one that you sit under, ask his counsel. You didn't want me to tell you. You didn't want me to tell you that. She's brazen and bold. She won't sit in on the services. She's go out and take off her dress and put on pants. And she got this black magic. And says to her mother, what would it have been like if I'd have been a boy? How would you have thought? And now she's even moving in that direction. You think that some boarding school is going to straighten that half out? She's going to have to die. You don't get that. See, folks don't love me and they don't like me. But that's all right. They didn't love Yeshua. That's all right. It's all right. Oh, it's all right. Deep down in my life, he said, they sacrifice their children to devils, this stronghold, this power that takes strength in your mind, your idea about life, your principle. These are powerful strongholds. I'll show you what they produce now. Listen to this quickly. First Baruch chapter 4, verse 7. Same thing that we just said. Same thing, Dibarim. It says in 1 Baruch 4 and 7, for you provoke Almighty Yahweh. 1 Baruch 4, 7. For you provoke Yahweh, him that made you, by sacrificing unto Shadim, and not to Yah. You have given everything unto demons. But you don't offer unto Yah Torah and praises, and your home filled with the vials of fragrant oil. You walk through your house and you sing. There's nothing more beautiful than that. That's why I tell your daughters all the time, your house is clean and your ruach clean. And you walk through the house, you're singing and you're rejoicing. And when your man comes home, he may be down, but it lifts him up and strengthens his mind. And it's ruach. We're hard-headed. But Heifer, you could listen to that Johnny Mack singing the love songs. You don't know what love is. He sang lust songs, demon songs, devilish songs, and wicked songs of his proudness and his carousing with others and other men's wives and all of that. You sit there on your lazy buttocks. Your house should be spotless so when your man walks through the door, he can sense the fragrance of your ruach, your bosom. You don't have to say a thing. You sense that he's weary, he's tired. You don't find that today. These women don't know how to love. They haven't been taught how to love a man, to honor him. That's why you all want me to teach them how to love. And once they began to learn how to do that, believe me, when a man loves, he loves. Ain't nothing like a man's love. For Yah is a man of war. Yeshua was a man. The power of Yah's love was in him. But a man loves. It's no pretense. It's real. Well, he spoke hard to me. Well, I'm quite sure you've not spoken hard to your youngins, anything like that. Don't tell me you haven't spoken hard to him either. This is such hypocrisy. We're so superficial, so false. You show a wise man his ways are in error, he loves you. Say, that's right, preaching man. I like the way you talk. You're talking to me. That's right, Raah. That's me. Help me. I need help. I'm a mess. We don't want to say that today. Got an excuse for everything. You're going to die that way. Hallelujah. For you have provoked Yah. And you have sacrificed to Shadim, demons. And you have not shown Yahweh any kind of great love because of the power of that vile, foul spirit of yours. That's pigul. We act like pigs. Pig will eat anything, will it not? I don't care what it is, a pig will eat anything. It is just like a sturgeon fish or something like that. They have no bones, nothing but cartilage. No blood vessels. And a pig has that either. That's amazing that nothing poisonous. And the truth of Yah doesn't affect the pig. A pig will always run, turn against Yah. I want to show us something again. I want to revisit one verse that we read in Revelation. In Revelation chapter 8, verse 2. It said, has become the whole, that is the stronghold. The whole Revelation 8 to 18:2, it has become the whole of every fire, pichgul spirit there is. That's what it says, doesn't it? I must clarify that through some process in the Torah. I must do that. Well, let me begin here in Shirak. Now, we'll show you what the stronghold. It's easy for me to identify she as a liar or him as a liar, her as a liar. But we never think that we lie to ourselves and we lie in that strong tower of our pride and our arrogance. Those are two powerful spirits. Pride go before fall and haughtiness and arrogance before destruction. But we never think. We can tell when I'm telling a lie. I can tell when you're telling a lie. I said to Oxymeon the other day, I said, I tell you what. I said, when we start sorting this ward over here, I said, I know what we're going to do. I said, I know the brothers. I know the brothers. I know what power they will go to. I know what the brothers will do. I know them big pieces over there. I said, I know what the brothers. Why are you shaking your head up and down? I said, the reason I know what the brothers will do. I said, I know what I will do. I come over here, I'm looking for the big pieces. I'm an ach. I said, I know what the achim will do. I said, now we will start there. And each of us will start there. Because I know what they will do. Well, I know what I would do. You start throwing that bin. This is my bin right here. Like, no, 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 sir. I got them big pieces. Talk to me, achim. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Let's go to my house. That go to my house. Yes. I said, I know they will do that. How do you know that? Because mama, I would do the same thing. You put that big piece in that tin, it'll last a long time. So I will do what they will do. So I cannot incriminate them without incriminating me. But listen to this now. This is the way we are. It says in Shirach chapter 20, verse 24. This is one of the most foulest of spirits that we, within our own bed, our house, we have been brought into captivity. It says, a shechan, a lie. Shirach 20:24. A lie, listen now, it is an ugly miosh, foul. Stop there. I'll go right back to Revelation chapter 18, verse 2. It has become the stronghold of every foul spirit. Does it say that? It has become the stronghold of every foul spirit. Sharat gives us clarity of the nature and the power of the very attitude of the Shadim, or the demons. Because he was a liar from the beginning. And the reason he was a liar, because he abode not in Torah. Look at what Shirach says again. Shirach 24, 20 and 24. A lie is an ugly, foul, beosh, blot on a man. Yet it continuously on the lips of the ignorant and untaught. When you find an ignorant man, when you find an ignorant woman that cannot be taught, they lie day and night. It is on the lips of those that are ignorant and unlearned. They are bound by the captivity of that. He said continuously. It is continuously on their lips. It is in their mind. It is the stronghold of them. And he says, I want to tell you something. He said, a thief is preferable to a habitual liar. I'd rather be around a thief. In my days, I was around hustlers and thieves that would not steal from me. He said, a thief is preferable to a habitual liar. He said, but the lot of both of them is hell. That doesn't mean the thief is getting by. He said, the lot of both of them is hell. This is one of the most vilest, one of the most foul pigul. When one does that, that's why they're bound by it. They lie to their minds. Oh, he lied to me. No, my friend, you lied to yourself. Well, she told that lie. Well, tell me, baby girl, how many lies have you told? We don't want the straight upness in the Yasha, the uprightness of a messenger of Yah. No, the Shabbat, you're not going to burden Yahshua down with nothing. You're not coming here with no burden at all. So a lie is an ugly, foul. It has become the habitation of every foul. Here. That's what has become the habitation, the dwelling place of every foul. Demonic power. You need something greater than your tonic on rock or your gin sipping tonight. You need the power of the sword to be free from that. Yah's got to break that stronghold. He had to break Hashatan down and cast him out of the kingdom. He's got to be cast out of our minds. And that's why he says that a thief is preferable to a liar, but the lot of both of them is ruins. And the disposition of a liar is dishonorable. When you find one that lies, they are dishonorable. When you lie to yourself, you dishonor the body of Yahshua, the mind of Yahshua. When you allow that stronghold to lie to you, and you know you're wrong and say you're right, that's a stronghold. No one wants to confess their sins. That's why we saw in Revelation that they cannot shub. They cannot make teshuva. They cannot repent of their sins. Why? Because their minds have become the stronghold of every kind of demonic power, every kind of unclean thing. And it begins with this administration of this foul spirit, this pigul, that they love to lie. And they lie to themselves and speak lies to themselves and things that comfort them in their lives. The disposition of a liar, it is one that is very dishonorable. And I want you to hear this. And his shame, your shame, daughter, your shame, my friend, it is ever with them. Now, that's a profound statement there. It is forever with them. They never lose that cloak. I don't believe that, man. Turn quickly to Revelation chapter 22. We must understand what the Melchut is, the kingdom. The Melchut is the knowledge of this revelation of Yahshua that cause us to walk in the kingdom way. They cause our steps to be ordered. The steps of a Siddiq man, it is ordered by Yah. And Yah says the shame is always with a liar. You can lie to yourself. You can allow that demon to keep you under that delusion. But this is what Yah says. you can't even enter into the kingdom blessings. I know that this is this has some bit of a metaphor in the sense that it is a reality, but it is a statement for us today. This book is not for something that's going to happen 10 years from now. It is a today's book. And we see the manifestation of it every day and all day. But this is what the prophet says here in Revelation 22, verse 15. He talks about the kingdom. And those that are the Melkut of the kingdom, mine. Thy kingdom come. Thy kingdom come. We're in the earthly vessels. Thy kingdom come. Dwell in me. As the prayer of Zoc came to me, constantly resonated at the beginning of every service. And this is what the Nobi speaks to us. Revelation 22, 15. For outside of the kingdom, we will see the Echene, or the dogs. These are those that prostitute their minds, and they sell themselves to lies and corruption. That's what a chelap is. They were known as, quote, temple prostitutes, men and women. They sell themselves. He says, now you know, notice the conjunction. It's not a comma. He used the word for outside are dogs. Then he used the word and. When there's a noun and the multiples of nouns, when you get to the last noun, then you only use and. But he says, and sorcerers or those that are kashaf, and those that allow the power of witchcraft to play in their minds, and they pretend and they play with themselves. That's what he says. For without. These are outside of the kingdom, knowledge and revelation. He says, and not only that, but those that are zana, and he uses and again. Doesn't it say that? And. He wants to be precise. And whoremongers, those that are unfaithful, that you sacrifice your children to hell. You don't trust me for the smallest things, for bread and life. Ah, what a price we're going to have to pay. He says, and also there will be no ratash, murderers. You hate Israel without a cause. Moshe chose rather to suffer with the people of Yah than to enjoy the pleasure of sin for a season. You hate their fellowship, but you can smile and grin with the wicked, but you're murderers. You plan to kill. You strategize your wickedness. And you deploy your wickedness among Yah's house. That's what this generation does. He calls them ratash, they're murderers. He says, and not on that, and again, does it say and? No comma there, baby. And idolaters or hebel, those that are so wickedly and damnable, empty, they're full of vanity, soothsaying and witchcraft, that they think highly of themselves, and they motivate themselves with lies and every kind of vile corruption. You better hear me. These are powerful strongholds. You're not going to bring them down through counseling or philosophy. They're not coming down. Then he says this, And whosoever love to make, or whosoever love to live a life that based upon lies, he said they're not going in the kingdom. They're not going in the kingdom. That's a powerful stronghold. Do you understand the stronghold that keeps you out of the kingdom knowledge? And keep you out of the kingdom revelation? That's powerful. Keep your mind shackled whereby you can't hear, that you're convinced of your sins and your wicked way. That's powerful. That's powerful. You can say what you want to show you how violent, how vanity, how full of vanity, shav you are. That's powerful. That's powerful. That has to be brought down. Not that I'm overeating. Well, you get that right. You don't have to worry about overeating and all the rest of that. Yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah. Baruch said the shame is with them forever. And these things will be with you. Yeshua said, you're going to die in your hatah, your sins, you're going to die that way. We don't have to buy that, but it's the truth. I warn us. I don't know how to speak any other way. I don't know how to talk other ways. I don't know how to preach any other way. I don't know how to. I'm not an intelligent preacher. I'm not a speech of scholarship. But I know when I study this book, and it takes me to the parameter of this book, that everything may be line upon line, line upon line, line upon line, line upon line, precept upon precept, everything, here a little, there a little, that we may realize for one reason, Yah does that for one thing, that we don't see our wickedness. That's why he tells us line must be upon line, line upon line, precept upon precept. Because we were wicked, that's why he said that. You can't distort the word Yisrael, and that's what this foul spirit of lying will do, that we lie to ourselves and we pretend to ourselves that we're right and we're walking right, and we are not walking right at all, period, Yisrael, we are not walking right. These are foul spirits. I would certainly like to deal with every aspect of this, the unclean spirits, but I have too many other things to teach on. I want to deal with this application for a moment, all right? Shirak says here, in Shirak, in chapter 5, verse 14, the writings of the Torah. Shirak chapter 5, verse 14. You will see the manifestation of this foul spirit in a way that is so pigul. And it draws from every kind of foul spirit. It makes a broth or a stew, and it drinks the stew of every unclean lie and unclean action, unclean activity. Listen to what he says. Do not call a slanderer or a slander. Do not karah, do not speak of them a slander or a whisper, a busybody, a gossiper. Your daughters, take care of your houses and shut your wicked mouths. I'm talking to you. You that have joined me in everybody's affairs, nosy as they come, got time for everything, but don't have time to clean your wicked mess up. She's sweet. No, she's not sweet. He's not a fine brother. When you call a slanderer or a whisperer, do not call a slanderer or a whisperer, and do not lie, do not wait in ambush with your tongue. Don't allow your tongue to try to ambush someone. Don't do that. That's why you need to shut your damnable wicked mouths and speak the right word on time. Yeah. I hate when people say things like that. You don't know what you're saying. Stop it! Shut your mouth. Don't allow your tongue to lie in ambush. Why? For a foul. That's a foul demonic power that controls. For a foul shame is to the thief. A foul shame. Well, what is Hashatan? Is he not a thief? He comes to steal, kill, and to destroy. So you tell me he's not a foul shame and a blot upon the very order of Yah? And that's his nature. Our mouths corrupt and make us strong and defiant, a hole that holds us in bondage. I recall as a little child, my ignorance, when we pray for the devil. I'm not praying for the devil. You're not going to do that, are you? Who's going to pray for the devil? No more than I'm praying for these devils out here. I pray not for them. I pray for the Beit Yisrael. We need to learn how to care for each other. And you began with that by embracing and caring and showing your kindness to each other. That's how you do it. You began by considering each one and every one. That's how you do it. I don't care if folks don't like me. You don't like yourself when you don't like me. Because you got to love me, right? You know you got to love me. You might as well. I don't care if you get upset with me, so what? You get upset with yourself, don't you? So it doesn't make me different if people get upset with me, they get mad with me. I don't care. I don't care. It doesn't bother me one bit. I don't lose no sleep. I don't get up. I don't toss and turn at night. When I go to bed, I go to bed. Hear this. I'm teaching you something that you can't even teach yourself. Now, we should not be foolish who get upset when someone reach out and touch you and tell you about you. It's almost like a child. The parents tell us, I mean, time to go to bed. I shall. That's the way we are. Quit you like a little boy. Let us be men, Yisrael. Hallelujah. That foul spirit, a foul shame come upon a thief. And look what it says now. Does it say S-E-V-E-R-E? That's severe, a great, severe condemnation to the double-tongued. That's why we all have to speak the same thing. Not just condemnation, but severe condemnation. Upon those that speak one thing and the power of that stronghold have them under this foul delusion and this vile delusion that they don't even realize that they are under this vile, wicked delusion. They don't realize that. And then when we are under this foul, this pigul, we allow every kind of unclean, every kind of vile thing to penetrate our minds, and we become a servant to those things. We must serve Yah Yisrael. And that, what do you think the word Ra'ah? It's not Riach, but that's all right. But Ra'ah. Ra'ah, it has multiple expressions with the same phonics. But the Ra'ah is one that, this is what a true messenger of Yah does. He brings us to those places where we need to graze. When the sheep graze on all this, we got them over here now. And they're getting fat, and they get fat. So when the cows graze this down, we have to take them to the place that will nourish them and give them nutrients. We have to feed them with things that will make their body strong and their meat tender and their meat nice. And so that's what he does. He takes us to the place because he can look, and you can look at a cow and say, that cow is lacking. It's getting over thin. It's got the runs. And we must be able to look at the house of Yah and say, you need this daughter, you need this son, you need this son, you need that daughter. We must be able to do that. If we don't do that, then we are hireling. Yeah. We flee when the wolf comes. I don't care about the attitudes of people. Never have. I'm not going to let that bind me. That's what I tell people when I tell people, don't come here when I tell you that. Listen to me first. Because you're not going to like me when you come. We saw the last little fellow and all that regalia he had. You're not coming here with that boy. No, sir, you can take that somewhere else. And I guarantee he'll listen to me again. Makes no difference how old I am, I said, doesn't it? Silly little boy. He got on his set apart. I'm set apart today too. I got Yeshua on my mind. My salvation is sure, my helmet. I got a sword in my hand today. My breast, my shots. My loins girded about, my feet prepared by this truth that I'm teaching today. I'm a Geba. I'll have you a Geba. Not a Geba, but a Geba, or just a warrior. You're not coming here with that. Oh, I listen to you. No, you haven't. You have not. I can tell the way you bring your youngins here and your family, and I told you don't bring them here like that. Oh, you don't have to. We dress this. I said, listen to me, man. Don't come here that way. Then you defy that. You defy that. You're not listening to me. When your wife with a dress on, you can see everything she wants. She's so unsure of herself. She wants you to see her leggies, her legs. Heifer, put on a dress to cover yourself. Put on. I don't understand why all the women, they just want to get naked. They think they got something just, you know. I don't care if a woman is that big. You're that tall. She's a woman. It's no different. She's a woman. She's still a woman. And there's no difference between you and her. It makes no difference. Period. You learn the word of the heathens like a dog. The male dog, it makes no difference. The male dog, it makes no difference. I don't care if he's a Great Dane, Chihuahua. He can make a dog. And the physicality was there, then he will make a dog. It's just silly and immature. It's sad. Especially you daughters of the dark hue. It's sad. I love you. It saddens me. I was thinking the other day, and I'm going to say this. I'm going to finish up here. For me, at my age, something was to happen to her. I would never look for a wife. I would not. I wouldn't want a wife. Because I know with all these years what I have and the friendship and the love, I won't look for one. Because I will put no woman under that kind of scrutiny. I'll be all right hanging with her. I can only hang now. And Shimmer's gone, so I can just hang with Yo, and I can hang with Oximion. I said, we'll hang, man. Fuss at each other, get mad. Go home, Simeon. Maybe Yo teach me a little sign language, and we walk in the woods. He'll get happy about that. He'll be happy to teach me that. Do a little bird watching. I do a little crying. No, I would not. No, I would not. I would not want the baggage. I would not all the youngins and they, Mama, I would have, no! I would not, that's me now. That's me. That's me, me now. That's me. I will not tell any other man to do what, that's me now. That's just me. That's just me. I would not put a woman through that. I would not. I'll be all right. What I do? Well, I'll just go to the gym more, and I don't have to worry about making up the bed. Like Dooley said, I'll just get up in the morning. I don't have to pull a cover. Change the sheets once a week. I don't have to worry about that. No, I would never make the bed up. Well, yes, I would. I would clean it up. I like a clean house and all that. I really do. Keep things orderly. And I'll just probably put a bed down there in my office. Probably will not even use the rest of the house. That's just honest truth. I'm being honest with you. Because where do you really find a daughter today? Okay. I want to close with a few scriptures here, all right? I want to show us when we open unto this. Let me read this in Shirak. You can never finish up the works of Yah. I want to read this. We're going to rest after this, all right? Let me read this. This is a prayer of the son, Mishrach, Yeshua. In Shirak 51, verse 1, we must be God giving Todah to you, O mighty Yah. O Yah the King, and I will praise you, O Yah my fragrance, my Yoshak. I give Todah to your name, for you have been my protector. He is our stronghold, Yisrael, our Masud. He is our Ezra, our help. And he has been our Yoshak for the body from destruction and from the great snares of what? This is a foul spirit now, of the slanderous tongue, from the lips that utter lies. Now that's what the spirit does. This is what they shot them. They lie against Yah. They lie against his name. They lie to your mind. And people slander Yah, and they from that slander tongue. He goes on to say, he says, before those who stood by you was my helper. And then he says in verse 3, and did deliver me, you Yah, in the greatness of your kindness. That's how he deliver us, because that's our stronghold. He's kind to us. And the greatness of your kindness and your name from the gnashing teeth about to devour me. That's what a lion has. A lion devours. He doesn't chew. It doesn't eat and snack. It devours. It takes a chunk of meat and swallows it. That's how it does it. It doesn't bite. That's sure and savory. And he goes about as that. It devours. From the hands of those who sought my life, for many afflictions I endured.
He said, from the token fire on every side, from the middle of the fire which I did not kindle. There are things that I was tried by as the forces of hell, because Babel has fallen. We are in a nation, we're in a land where when you meet people, you can just see the confusion. I do. They're ignorant today. Hallelujah. This is what he says here in verse 5. He says, from the depths, folks can tell you what they want to. He says, from the depths of the belly of hell, from an unclean tongue, and from lying words. That's where he needs to deliver us from. From the belly of your darkness, from the foul nature of your lies, from your unclean tongue. That's a stronghold, Yisrael. It binds us. It's the thing that bring up thoughts and ideas. You got to cast them down to the gates of hell. You must not allow them to be established in your mind. That's why the whispers and the gossipers, people don't realize that it is a spirit of necromancing, or it's transforming. It is a spirit of worship. And you call, it's enchanting. You're calling upon demons. And so you sit there. There are folks who sit all day and talk about everything but their sins. They will talk about everybody but them. They can show you what's wrong with everybody but them, but me, myself, and I. You're calling on that. You're giving credence to that stronghold and fortifying that you feel right. You feel better about you. You're a fool. You are a flat-out fool. You are a fool. I love you. I'm glad he corrects me. And that's not a message that any of teach here that it doesn't correct me. It's not a message that they teach that I don't get hundreds of messages from their teaching. I may teach it different, but I get that because I know how to listen. So deliver me from that slanderous, what? My own tongue and that stronghold of my own lie. That's why we have to be careful. We must be quick to hear. We like to respond quickly and slow to speak. We must do that. We're the woman of Yah. We have to be careful how we talk. We have to be careful how you talk, man. Now my words are measured. I know what I'm saying. You just throw it off at the mouth. And this is a powerful stronghold. That's why the men say we're not going to repent. We're right. You're not going to tell us. They will say to the mountains, fall on us, hide us from the wrath of him to come. They will not say, I'm sorry. And we won't say that, I'm sorry. I did you wrong, man. Man, I was flat out wrong. Woman, I was wrong, daughter. My childish ways, these were the things that stopped me or impeded me from doing it. We don't want to say that because it's a true state of immaturity and no growth at all. You can tell when the cows, them little, those, they call them yearlings. When they're less than a year old, they call it a yearling. I looked the other day, I seen when they, one bit of me say, the cow's calfing. Well, when they get up, they struggle. They can hardly walk. And mama licked them and stimulate the flow of the blood. And they find the teat. And all of a sudden, it doesn't take 2 days. An hour or two, they got their foot on the thing. And I love to see when they just run, where they get. Don't laugh at me, son. I'll crack your head. They get it going, man. They rock. So full of life and energy. So full of it. And they follow mama. They go to her place where she's going to graze. We have been birthed from above. So we must eat from the pastures of Yerushalayim. You could eat in the filth. Last verse here. Hallelujah. I want to give you two things of confidence. First of all, I've read this before, but it's in Shemot, Exodus chapter 15:3. We got the command of all commanders that he made every spirit. Exodus 15:3, Yah is an ish of war, and Almighty Yahweh is his name. That's our sure confidence there. He's a warrior. He's not going to, he lets nothing come. That's what we can see with Uriah and Dawid. He didn't let his sensual drive overtake him. He loved the king. And when the king thought that he had his mind in delusion with drunkenness and said, take him home, send him out, he went to guard the king's door. He went and guarded the king's door, and he slept right at the king's door. And because of his conscience of his wickedness, he said, put him out in the midst of the heaviest battle. And Uriah, he loved that confidence the king had in him. So Yah says for us, you in this time, I've caused you to be birthed in this time, that my name and the power of my ability to protect you, that you will stand and men will see the greatness of my power upon you. So he has elected you above all people. And we're so silly for something that has no value. Let us learn how to really love each other. And you began with loving yourself, and you know you love you when you correct yourself. When you can discipline yourself and get the foul spirit out of your mind and stop lying to you, you will know, you know you're learning how to love. And once you do that, then you can learn how to love someone else. Until you do that, you're not going to love anyone. He is a man of war, so that's my protection. I know that I can do all things through. We can bring down, cast out all strongholds through this masterful warrior by one testimony. Yahshua is in me. And if we just call on that name, Yahshua, my King, Yahshua is the great one. If you sing it enough, it makes you start feeling nice, won't it? Yahshua, just sing it. You don't have to add no words to it. Yahshua. Just keep singing it. And Yahweh gives us this. I'm not going to tell you where it's at. I'm going to read it. Who is the king? The Melech of Chabot. A great honor. Greatness. He says, Yahweh that is strong. He is Izuz. He got great strength. He's powerful. He's mighty. And not only is Yahweh strong, and he is Gibor. He is mighty. And he gives us this confirmation. Yahweh, mighty in battle. He is the one that's mighty in battle. For the weapons of our warfare, they are not carnal. He is the one that's mighty in battle, Yisrael. He is the one that subdue our enemies and bring down the strongholds and crush them down to the ground. Yahweh is his name. He is mighty and he is strong. We can do it. We can. So when Yah speaks to you of your ills and your inabilities, just bless him. Don't become grandizing and arrogant. Don't do that to Yah. Say, bless you, Yah, that you will even speak to me. That every son, every daughter receive, he chastens and corrects. He rebukes us and corrects us. Betimes, all the time he's going to do that. May the riches of your rest upon your nation, your heart be filled. You that have joined us and listening, send an offering, you all. Bless you all. In all things we do, Barach, you are Aban Yahshua's name. Bless us all. Bless you for this day. Heal us. For we need your healing in Yahshua's mighty name. Strengthen your nation, I pray. And guide us all in Yahshua's name. Hallelujah. 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 Yabrak Yisrael.